Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Spring Valley Baptist Church. We're so glad that you're here. And if you are a guest here today, if you're visiting us for the very first time, we want to welcome you. Why don't we give our guests a big welcome today? Now, if you are a guest here today, we do have these connection cards. We'd love it if you could fill one of these out. They are in the seat back that's in front of you. You can fill one of these out. Turn it in on your way out through this way or that way, and we will make sure you get a special gift. You'll get a phone call from someone on our ministry team and a letter from one of our pastors as well. You know, we have a lot of great things going on here at the church that I want to share with you all today. But as you may have noticed, before I go any further, we have, as the governor has lessened some of the restrictions, we've also been able to lessen some of our restrictions. You may have noticed that we've opened up the roads that were closed, but we are asking that we all still do our best to remain as safe as possible and be as socially distanced as possible, even though we now have all of our roads that are potentially being used. Now, in your bulletins today, there were several inserts, and we want you to take a look, but if you would take out the one that says the Church Health Report, because in this, what we are doing is we are desiring that you all would take a survey on your computers so that we can assess our church's strengths as well as our church's weaknesses. You know, we know that our church is a wonderful church, an amazing church, but we can always do better. So what we're asking, as you see this survey, you can either go to your search engine and type in this link, or if you have one of those really cool QR scanners on your smartphone, you could scan that little barcode, and it'll bring you right up to the link. It'll take you maybe 15 or 20 minutes to fill out that survey. Please don't do it while we're having services, unless it's Pastor Mitch that's teaching, and then, no, just kidding. We love Pastor Mitch. We're very thankful for it. You know, that's one of the beauties about our relationship, Pastor Mitch and I, is that we can kind of jab at each other, and we still love one another, and you guys all know that, right? All right, I hope so, because I would never want you to think that I don't like that man over there, because he's been a great mentor to me. So if you would just take that survey, we're going to do this. We're going to give you the next 3 weeks to do it, okay? It's only a 20-minute survey, don't get me wrong. It's not going to take you 3 weeks, but sometime between now and the next 3 weeks, if you would fill this out, it would really help us out a lot. Next week, next Saturday, we are going to have a church outreach in the park, and this time it is going to be a Desert Breeze Park. Now, there's three goals in this outreach for next week. The number one goal is obviously to reach young children and their families for Jesus Christ. But as our church has gotten a little bit of experience now doing church park outreaches, we are also going to be training other churches to be able to do what we're doing in the park so that more churches could be sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, the third aspect of the goal for us is that we are partnering with Good News Clubs. For those of you who may not be familiar with Good News Clubs, as of before COVID, we were in over, our church was sponsoring one club, but the Good News Clubs were in over 50 different schools in the school district here in Clark County. But then when the schools got shut down, they had to come up with unique ways to reach the children. So they're doing a lot of different park outreaches. Well, because our park reaches very animated, you know, I'm a little animated, so you can imagine what our park outreach is like. We're training other churches so that they can do it, so then the Good News Clubs can come in after us and continue to have park outreaches, or at least Good News Clubs in the park from then on out. So it's really a good thing. We're really excited about ministering to our young people, and that's why Frankie, who you met a couple weeks ago, is having a meeting today after this service to raise up new volunteers as well as our existing volunteers to help out with our children's ministry. Our goal is to not only have a full program here at the 10:45 a.m. service, but that we can go back to having a full program at the 9 a.m. service as well. But we can't do it without your help. So if you're interested in that, if you've been praying about it since we announced it last week, make sure that you stop by in the fellowship hall after service today. Frankie promises to keep it really quick. And then lastly, as you guys know, we really want to just, we want to share the love of Jesus with all our friends and neighbors and coworkers and the people that we know. So who do you know that you've been praying for? Remember, we've asked you for several weeks now to be praying that God's going to raise up or lead somebody to you that you can lead to the Lord or share the gospel with or invite them to come to church. And our hope and our goal is that on Easter Sunday, we're going to have three services and that at each of those services, people are going to get baptized as they've already given their lives to the Lord. So who's your one? Be praying about that and invite them to come to church so that they can get born again and saved and baptized and growing and discipled in the Lord. Now, the last thing we're going to do before we continue with our worship is I am inviting Grant Estes to come up, and he's going to give us a quick update. He's going to give us a quick update about our pastor's search team committee.
Good morning, church. So I have been tasked with the privilege of giving you the update for the pastor search team. It has been 10 months, and we have been diligently seeking God's face in the man that he will bring to Spring Valley. So we have been fasting one meal every week for those 10 months, asking for God to reveal his man for us here at Spring Valley. And we are, at this point, pursuing one individual who we believe God is calling, and we have to continue that process and so that we can present him to you guys as a sure candidate. And we are getting closer and closer. And at this stage, we are asking that you would join us in prayer. We are asking that you would fast with us and seek God's face for our church here at Spring Valley. And we are pursuing God's highest purpose for us in God's man. And so we ask that you would look through this bulletin announcement, that you would read it, and that you would sign it in dedication, saying that you are praying with us. It is such an encouragement that you would sign this, rip off your name, and stick it in a jar over here, because then we know and are assured that God's will be done, because you are united with us, and we together are pursuing God's kingdom, pursuing God's man. And so we ask you to diligently join us to pursue God. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Grant. And as we continue to pray for our pastor search team, pray for God's clarity and God's call on the man that he is preparing to bring to Spring Valley as our pastor. Let's continue to worship this morning. I'm going to invite you to stand and read God's word with us out of Romans. Let's read together. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Hebrews 12, 1b and 2.
Awesome.
is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than ever.
Thank you for the cross, that cross that our Savior was nailed to, that instrument of torture that was used so that we could have our sins forgiven. Lord, we do cling to that old rugged cross, not as a piece of jewelry that we might wear around our necks, not as a symbol that is up in our churches for us to worship, but we cling to the cross because the cross, without it, we wouldn't be here today. And without the cross and the resurrection, we would not have everlasting life. So, Father, we thank you for that cross. And we ask that you would help us to bear that cross in our lives every single day. We pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We're going to share just an instrumental worship offering this morning. The tune you will probably recognize, the text on the screen, like for you to read as we share. This is one of my students. His name is Jackson Briley. Jackson played an instrumental worship offering for us in 2020, and we don't have a whole lot of opportunities to play in the current climate we have, and I asked him if he would come and play for us today an offering in worship.
Thank you.
Great job. You know, our mission here at Spring Valley Baptist Church is to love God, to love one another, and to make disciples. And this is what discipleship is, you guys. This is what Pastor Barry is doing with young people. He is training them up. He is teaching them. He's engaging them in the ministry of the church so that the future generation is going to be around for as long as God will have us to continue to bring forth God's word. Speaking of discipleship, I'm about to introduce somebody to you who has discipled so many people through his preaching and teaching of God's word over decades. And his name is Pastor John Pretlove. And he and his wife, Catherine, have been part of our church now for about a year as members of this church. And we are blessed to have Pastor John preach and teach God's word with us here this morning. Thank you, Pastor John.
It's a bad start. It's a joy and a privilege to be sharing with you this morning, and I thank the pastors for their willingness to let me loose. Some of you will wonder. Excuse me, this is just that's coffee. I grew up in England, and when you were thirsty, you didn't go for water. That was cold, and you were cold anyway. It's like some of you have experienced going to England and in a restaurant asking for iced tea, and they've looked at you as if you were from Mars. But the Lord brought us to America 10 years ago. Erase that from your mind, please. I was a pastor in England for 10 years, and one morning I was reading the word, and the Lord hit me with, "You've been at this mountain long enough." So I said to my wife, "See if the Lord's saying anything," and I left it like that. She came back and said, "It's the strangest passage. It says pack an exile's baggage." Monday morning. Thursday night, 11 o'clock, phone call came from Dallas. They'd got the time change wrong. First Baptist Church in Dallas would like you to come and help them. And, hey, there are those who say God doesn't speak to us. I'm so sorry for them. And what a blessing it is to have a godly spouse with whom you can check when you sense the Lord's leading. So, came to Dallas, and then the Lord moved us over to Las Vegas. I was retired, and I left town, and my wife sent my resume to First Baptist Church of the Lakes. They needed a resume, and the Lord told her to do it, she said, and that was the start of being there for 14 years. And I retired from there, but I want to mention to you that we were well aware that First Baptist Church of the Lakes had been helped by you at a very significant time. And we were grateful for that. All right. Turn, please, in your copy of the scriptures to Philippians chapter 3. Our conviction is that the authority for what the preacher says comes from the Word of God, and it's your job for there to be an open Bible in the pew by which you can make sure that what is coming from the pastor's Bible is in fact correct. So just keep those Bibles open day by day, week by week. Reading in Philippians chapter 3. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh, for we are the real circumcision, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone else thinks he has confidence, reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we ask for the ministry of your Spirit in the preacher and in the hearer, so that we may hear your voice to our hearts. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the text starts, finally, my brothers. Paul is halfway through his letter, and he says, finally, don't believe a preacher who says, finally. All right, look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision. We are the people of God who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. There's always a background when someone writes something like this, and the background is very clear. Jesus, of course, had come, lived, ministered, died, crucified, rose again, and ascended into heaven, and 10 days later came the day of Pentecost. The man chosen to preach on the day of Pentecost was the one none of us would have chosen, the one who blew it 3 times in denying the Lord. the Lord chose him to speak on the day of Pentecost. Have you ever realized how gracious the Lord is with those who blow it? Amen. Peter preached on the day of Pentecost, and 3,000 came to faith. 3,000 Jews came to faith. If you go to chapter 4, verse 4 in Acts, you find that 5,000 Jewish men have come to faith. Chapter 5, verse 14 tells us that multitudes more have come to faith. All Jewish. Go to chapter 8. Stephen, of course, has preached and been stoned. The disciples are scattered. Philip goes to Samaria and preaches Christ in Samaria. The Samaritans were sort of half Jews. Let's leave it at that. But what happens in AD 40? Jesus crucified, rose again, apparently AD 33, could have been 30. But in AD 40, Cornelius was saved, together with his bunch. Cornelius, a bunch, and his bunch of Gentiles. This was the breakthrough into the Gentile world. Cornelius, in chapter 10 of Acts. Then, in chapter 11, we find more Gentiles being saved in Antioch in Syria. And there are Antiochs all over the place. I think that's due to Antioch, Antiochus Epiphanes and so forth. But Antioch in Syria, 200 miles north of Jerusalem. AD 40, a bunch of Gentiles start being saved. 9 years later, Acts 15, verse 1. Paul is in Antioch. Some men came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. These were from Judea, almost certainly members of the First Baptist Church of Jerusalem. Unless you're circumcised, you cannot be saved. You know, there's a fascinating spot in Colossians chapter 2 where it basically says that our being born again and baptized is the equivalent of Old Testament circumcision. But you'll just have to look at that later. Unless you're circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Paul and Barnabas heard this, and Paul was a little bit concerned. That's an underestimate. Paul was absolutely angry at what was being said, because it was a denial of everything he had come to stand for. So Paul writes the letter to the Galatians. And we haven't got time to go through all of Galatians this morning. Chapter 5, verse 1. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore. Do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Look, I, Paul, say to you that if you accept circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you. I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he's obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified by the law. Did you hear that? You are severed. You are cut off from Christ. You who would be justified by the law, you who would be circumcised after trusting in Christ, you have fallen away from grace. Now that means you have abandoned the concept of grace. The concept of grace is very simple. We're saved and we don't deserve it one scrap. We're saved, we don't deserve it. God gives salvation, but we don't deserve it. Grace. We do not in any way deserve to be saved. So what we've got here is two absolutely opposite views. Those teachers from Judea say, if you are not circumcised, you can't be saved. Paul and Barnabas, if you are circumcised, you cannot be saved. Why? Because you are trusting something you yourselves do. The devastating error is to say that trusting Jesus to save me is not enough. I have to contribute something. Circumcision, maybe. I have to contribute something to my salvation, which abandons the principle of grace. We're saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. God can't stand men boasting. What's worse is that the folk from Judea were saying, in effect, that what Christ has done for us wasn't enough to save us. Which drove Paul to say, beware of the dogs. Who are the dogs? How many legs have the dogs got? Did someone say four? Did I hear someone say four? The dogs had two legs. The dogs were the teachers from Judea. Now, let's get one thing straight. You can take the Greek word for dogs and translate it into English, and the English is dogs. You needed a bit of grammar. But it doesn't mean that. Let me illustrate that. If I was talking to Pastor Mitch and I was to call him a dog, I might end up flat on my back. That's not the deal. The deal is this. The word dog was used to mean Gentile. In Mark chapter 7, you've got the story of the Syrophoenician woman who asked Jesus for a miracle, and Jesus says, really should be giving it to the Jews first, not you dogs, in other words, you Gentiles. And she says, but the dogs get crumbs from under the table. She's happy to be called a dog, because the word dog to them meant Gentile rather than Jew. Okay? So the translation of the Greek word dog is the English word Gentile. All right? There we are. Okay. After chapter 15, verse 1 of Acts, which tells of those who'd gone from Judea, from Jerusalem, up to Antioch and been saying, unless you're circumcised, you can't be saved. Then there was the business meeting of the First Baptist Church of Jerusalem. There are those who call this the First Church Council. That proves they're either Presbyterian, Methodist, or Episcopalian. It's a local church being asked by another local church in Antioch, that is, to deal with a problem that some of their men have caused. Okay? It is the local church business meeting of the First Baptist Church in Jerusalem. And they dealt with the problem. But in fact, though that took place round about the year 49, as Paul is writing Philippians round about the year 62, it's still a living issue. How about in 2021? So I was driving into Dallas one Sunday morning. I turned on the wrong radio station and I heard a preacher saying, you've got to be baptized in the name of Jesus. You mustn't be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Well, actually you are, but the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, he said, is Jesus. Which blew my mind, and then I realized where he was coming from. There was an ancient heresy that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are essentially the same person dressed up in three different ways. It was actually called modalism. If some of you ladies are really up in fashion, you know that they talk about the Paris modes and so forth. There you are. Now, why is that a problem? It's a problem because our salvation is the result of the working together of the Father and the Son. The Father sends the Son. The Son says, I come to do your will. Isaiah 53, verse 6 puts it so clearly. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord, Yahweh, has laid on him, Jesus, the servant, the iniquity of us all. Our salvation involves a transaction between the Father and the Son. If the Father is the Son, it's absolute nonsense. That's why we cannot tolerate the doctrine of the United Pentecostal Church and so forth. So some insist you've got to be baptized in the name of Jesus. Some people are going to get pretty well complicated. There are those who say you've got to be baptized to be saved. But the most common error, I'll never forget, I was on a doorstep in Nebraska on a mission trip, and the lady who opened the door was a Methodist, and she was quite certain she was going to heaven. So I asked why she thought she was going to heaven, and she basically said, well, I've done a fair bit of good and not too much bad, and basically my good will outweigh my bad. What was she saying? I've got to add something. My goodness. My goodness. The father of lies has many lies. The basic lie is that you have to add to what Jesus has done. So Paul, in order to make things absolutely clear, gives us verse 3, Philippians 3, verse 3. We are the real circumcision. And he gives three characteristics of the real Christian. We are the real circumcision. One, who worship by the Spirit of God. And two, glory in Christ Jesus. And three, put no confidence in the flesh. The first mark of God's people, we worship by the Spirit of God. You go to John 3, and Jesus talks to the woman at the well, and when it looks as if she's going to be confronted with sin, she says, you say we should worship in Jerusalem. We say we should worship on Mount Gerizim here. What do you say? Jesus said, no. No. The hour is coming, is now here, John 4:23, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Worship is spiritual. It is not physical. It's not a matter of where your body is, nor is it a matter of what has been done to your body. It is spiritual. Worship, says Paul, is by the Spirit of God. What is the prime function of the Spirit of God? The Holy Spirit has been described as having a searchlight ministry. Most of you don't remember the Second World War. No, none of you remember the First World War. I was in London. And a mile or two up the road, there was a wide public space park sort of thing, in which there were searchlights. Their lens was about this wide. And when a German plane went over, they would point that searchlight. When they found that plane could not get away from that searchlight. And the artillery could shoot it down. The searchlight focused on the object. The Holy Spirit focuses on the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Spirit will bear witness about me, John 15:26. John 16:14, He will glorify me, for He'll take what is mine and declare it to you. Friend, as we worship, we need to ask the Holy Spirit to make the Lord Jesus real to us. And someone says, are you saying we should talk to the Holy Spirit? Absolutely. Worship by the Spirit of God. The second mark of God's people, we glory in Christ Jesus. Now, why should we glory in Christ Jesus? Well, the first thing we see is in verse 8 in Philippians 3. And he talks about the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus. Saying to know Him is so wonderful. All right. The second thing we find is he talks about not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but what comes through faith in Christ. I'm not standing before God with my goodness and my badness. Christ's perfect obedience is credited to my account. Hallelujah. A righteousness, not my own, that I produced. Then in verse 10, he talks about the power of His resurrection. If you know the Lord, He has been changing you by the power of His resurrection. You can talk about the new birth in many ways. In many ways, I think one of the best is it is our being plugged into the power of the resurrection. Well, that's all very well, but Paul has also written Philippians chapter 2. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though He was in the form of God, who is He? He is God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What did He do? He didn't count equality with God to be a thing to be grasped. He emptied Himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, He humbled Himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. What did Jesus do? He deliberately died in our place. He took on himself the punishment I deserve to endure eternally in hell. Glory to Jesus. Amen. His present position. Therefore, God has highly exalted him, bestowed on him the name that is above every name, the name Yahweh. The Jehovah's Witnesses will tell you the name above every name is Jehovah. Point them to this verse. They've got no answer for it. The name above every name is given to Jesus. And then there's his future position, Philippians 2 verse 10, at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven, on earth, under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Glory to Jesus, leaving the Father's throne, coming down, enduring all sorts of persecution, dying on the cross, now raised to the name above every name, every tongue confessing. Finally, chapter 3, verse 1, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. He's not just saying, brothers, rejoice in the Lord. He's saying, brothers, rejoice in the Lord. There is so much as we look at the Lord Jesus Christ for us to glory in, to rejoice in. That joy is crucial as a characteristic of the Christian. We glory in Christ Jesus. And are we doing it enough? Are we looking enough at the wonder of Jesus and glorying in him? But the third mark of the Lord's people, we're the circumcision who put no confidence in the flesh. And the basic thing is that this follows immediately on. If you're going to glory in Christ Jesus, how on earth are you going to boast about some little thing you did? We put no confidence. We don't trust in what we've done. We're trusting in what he's done. And hey, he works it out. He says, chapter 3, verse 4, I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh. If anybody thinks he's got reason for confidence in the flesh, I more. There's my religious heritage. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, my religious activity, a persecutor of the church. My living, my right living, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Putting no confidence in the flesh. What is the flesh? The flesh is typified by the words I and me and my. Okay? It's all about me. And Paul saying, I'd got that. But my thinking had to change. Verse 7 of chapter 3, whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I've I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as loss. Count them as rubbish. Count them as rubbish. Another translation has count them as dung. Neither of those is a good translation. A good translation of that word would offend you. I had to count all of that as trash. And the next three words are absolutely crucial. In order that. I might gain Christ. Paul says, for me to have Christ, it was necessary for me to reckon as worthless anything else I might contribute. Anything I might contribute, I had to regard as worthless in order to gain Christ. Christ will save you 100%, or he will save you 0%. He will not save you 99%. You have to count everything else as worthless. Oh, I hope you know that great hymn, Rock of Ages. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked, come to thee for dress. Helpless, look to thee for grace. Foul, all my righteousness is as filthy rags. Foul, I to the fountain fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. Friend, is that where you stand? That Jesus is the one who has saved you, and you don't think you contributed one scrap to your salvation? If you think you contributed something, my friend, you're sadly mistaken or very lost. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Friend, I don't know your heart. If you're listening, viewing, other than here, the message is the same. We don't know your heart. Are you trusting 100% in Jesus? If you aren't, come to him. You can never make yourself good enough for God, and he did it at so great a cost to himself, and his arms are open to save. He says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Rest for your souls. Let's pray. Lord, you know who needs this word more than anyone else. Apply it to the heart. Make clear their need. Let them hear your voice saying, come to me, and I will give you rest for your soul. Thank you for your wonderful word to our hearts. Thank you for dying in our place. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor John. This morning, as God's been ministering to your heart, maybe you understood your great need for salvation because you're a sinner, and you prayed today, and you received Christ as your Savior. Listen, if that was you today, please come speak to Pastor John or myself or Pastor Mitch. But you know, there was another group of people that Pastor John was referring to today, and that was the group of people like the woman that he ministered to on the mission trip, who'd been a religious person probably all of her life, and still didn't have that clear understanding that it wasn't about religion, it wasn't about what she can do for Christ, but what Christ had done for her. And maybe today, the Spirit of God has been ministering to you in that way. Maybe you've been a church goer your entire life, and you've been trusting in that. You've been trusting in your own works, or your own religion, or Jesus and. I think, Pastor John, you really taught us today in the word, through the word, that it's not Jesus and, it's Jesus, period. Jesus and Jesus alone. And he wants us to work. He wants us to serve. He wants us to do good things. Today we're going to have a children's ministry meeting, and we want volunteers. We want people to come and serve the Lord. But if we're doing any of those things because we think it's Jesus and, then as Pastor John said, we're gravely mistaken. This afternoon, our ministry spotlight today is about our young adult group. And you met Grant Estes earlier, and you may have met Grant and his wife as you've come in on Sunday mornings. But they have a young adult group that meets on Thursday evenings at 7 o'clock. And they study the Word of God. But you know what? As you can tell in these pictures, not only do they study the Word of God, but they like to have fun, right? You guys like to have fun. And you know what I love about this group is that they're welcoming. So, you know, in the top left-hand corner there's this guy with a hat on and a, you know, dark mustache and a gray goatee. They welcome whoever you are. So, you know, I don't know if I necessarily fit in. They were having game night that night, and I lasted about 45 minutes, and that was good enough. Then I had to go take a nap. No, just kidding. But pray for our young adults group. You know, the children's ministry, the young adults, this is the next generation, and I want us to really consider that because, you know, we got to think about what the church, if the Lord tarries, if Jesus doesn't come back today, if Jesus doesn't come back in this decade, what is the church going to look like? We have to reach the younger generation, and that's why we have young adult groups, and that's why we have children's ministry, and that's why we have Awana on Wednesday nights and youth group that meets. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for great men of your word like Pastor John Pretlove, who's dedicated his entire life to you. And Father, as we move forward, we also want to lift up this next generation as well, asking, Father, do a great work within this next generation. We want to see new Billy Grahams. We want to see new young men and young women who are on fire for Jesus, so that, Lord, if for whatever reason you decide to wait on your next on your second coming, that this next generation of believers will be on fire for you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, and it's in your precious name that we pray. Amen. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Pastor John and his wife Catherine will be here to answer any questions that you may have. Have a wonderful week.